I'm Samantha Morse, and my project this summer was determining the structure of DPO4 thymine glycol complex. Before you can do anything with determining the structure, you really need a good basis. So DNA contains all the genetic material in a cell, so it's really, really, really important. Without DNA, you literally would be nothing. It's made up of four bases, adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine, that are represented with A's, T's, C's, and G's. It's double-stranded, so every time you have an A, there's a T, normal DNA, and every time there's a C, there's a G on the other complementary strand. And it's alpha helical, which means it twists. Thymine glycol is a DNA lesion. There's two extra OH groups on the DNA base thymine, and you can see them right here and right here, those extra red balls. And it interferes with the structure of the DNA and how it's replicated. It actually causes a replicative block. Thymine glycol occurs naturally by free radicals, which are very reactive molecules. They occur naturally, and they can come from sunlight, and they can come from radiation. This includes radiation that's used in cancer treatments. So when good DNA goes bad, when a lesion is present and it's not fixed, DNA integrity is compromised. And because DNA is so important, you really can't afford to have it not work right. And this leads to cancers. So for example, sunlight can cause thymine dimers in your DNA. The TT dimers are replicated using a different type of protein, pol eta, I think it is. And if you don't have this particular polymerase, and if the TT dimers are not corrected, you get exodermal pigmentosa, and that almost always means you get skin cancer. So I got a little ahead of myself. So proteins are made up of amino acids. They start off, you can think of it as like a string, an amino acid. And they fold up on itself into a secondary structure and then a tertiary structure, and then it interacts with other subunits and forms a quaternary structure. Every protein has a unique three-dimensional structure, and the structure is extremely closely related to its function. And what is bound to the protein depends on the shape. These are two common proteins, collagen and hemoglobin. Collagen is found in muscle cells and in fake lips, and hemoglobin is found in your blood. And you can see they have very different three-dimensional structures. Polymerases are a special type of protein that replicates DNA. TAC is an example of a replicative polymerase. You can kind of think of that as how normal DNA gets replicated. Again, where A binds with T and C binds with G. The shape is kind of like a hand shape. There's a thumb and fingers and all that stuff. But the active site, this opening right here, is really small and very specific. DPO4, which is the protein that I'm working with, is a Y family polymerase, which is also called a translesional polymerase. And it has the same or a similar hand-shaped structure, but it's a little bit different. It has a much wider active site right here, and that's able to fit a bulky lesion. Okay, so this is just a brief overview of DNA replication and repair. Again, polymerases are proteins that replicate DNA. A binds with T, G binds with C. Y family polymerases or translesional polymerases bypass lesions. So in this animation here, you can see the yellow starts. It reads the top strand of DNA, which is called the template strand, and it places the correct base in the complementary strand. The X is a lesion, like thymine glycol, and it needs to bring in a special polymerase to bypass across the bulky lesion. That's why this big blue one comes in. You can kind of think of that one as DPO4. So it goes across the lesion, and then the normal polymerase comes back in and is able to copy the rest of the DNA. So my research question this summer was, how does the 3D structure of DPO4 change when bound to the DNA lesion thymine glycol, and how might this structural change relate to cancer and signs of aging? And why do we want to know this? Because the structure is so closely related to the function. And there is a structure of DPO4, but it's bound to regular, undamaged DNA. So this is something totally new, that it's now bound to this specific DNA lesion. So before we determine the protein structure, which we do using crystals, we need to grow and purify protein. We need lots and lots and lots of it. We need to purchase and purify the DNA that we need. And we need to determine the crystallization conditions for crystallizing DPO4 with the lesions binding glycol. And we do this by practicing with crystallizing DPO4 with unmodified DNA, because the unmodified DNA is much cheaper. So we start with growing protein. And so we grow E. coli cells overnight, and it's in a small amount. It's special E. coli that we've transformed, so it has this plasmid in it, so that the bacteria will express the gene that will make DPO4, because DPO4 is not naturally occurring in E. coli. Then basically the rest of these steps are just to make, we start off with about 10 milliliters and we end up with 4 liters. And it takes like 3 days. Then we need to purify the protein. This also takes a long time. And this, first we have to break the cells open. Then we centrifuge to get all the cell debris to the bottom and collect the protein. We pass it through this GST column, where the protein binds to these beads that are in the column. And then the protein is cleaved with a special protease. Next, the protein is concentrated. We can do this with centrifuging again. We assess the purity by running on an SDS gel. This is an example of an SDS gel. That big black band in lane 4 shows the protein. It separates by molecular weight, so it's a good way to tell what you have and based on where it comes out in the gel and making sure it's pure. Then we determine the concentration using a Bradford assay, which is just a standard laboratory technique, where we compare the UV absorbance of a known concentration of a standard protein with the absorbance of our known protein but of unknown concentration. The next step in this process was we had to buy the modified DNA and oligonucleotides, which are really, really expensive. So we bought them separately, but they were both purchased from the same lab at Yale. And we need both the primer strand and the template strand so that the protein can bind correctly, so we will get the crystals that we need. To purify the DNA, when the DNA arrives, it's in this little glass vial and it looks like a crusty film. So you dissolve it in water, you add loading dye, and you run it on an acrylamide gel. That's an acrylamide gel. It has the blue loading dye, and you just run it all the way to the bottom, and it takes all the extraneous stuff out of it. Then you cut the band from the gel, and you crush it up, and you soak it in water. Then you centrifuge again. It's our favorite thing, is to spin. And we get pure DNA out of that, which we then desalt, determine the concentration using the UV absorbance again and an oligo properties calculator, which is online. Then we are ready to actually do the real science, which is determining the protein structure. First we anneal the DNA primer and template because they're separate. You anneal them by mixing the primer and the template together in a 1 to 1.2 ratio. You boil the sample for 5 minutes and allow it to cool slowly. And then you can store it in the freezer until you're going to use it. This is a picture of a crystal tray. That's not any of us, it's just me. So we crystallize using the vapor diffusion method, where you mix the DNA with the protein and buffers and incoming nucleotide, and you add the buffers to a tray, and we did like a couple of screens of a variety of conditions where we varied the salt concentration, the pH, and the precipitants. You place a drop of the protein DNA mixture on a cover slip, and then you seal the well and you wait for 3 days to see if you get crystals. It's the tedious, long, tedious process. So the DNA is really expensive. So we practice first with lysozyme crystallization to make sure that the technique is there. This is it's a picture of a lysozyme crystal that I got. Then we also practice with the DPO4 and the undamaged DNA to determine the appropriate conditions for crystallizing DPO4 with the modified DNA. We base this on crystallization conditions that we found in different papers, and we had some problems for several weeks. We weren't getting any crystals. We changed conditions. Melissa and I worked on different trays, varying different things, and still weren't getting any crystals. So Dr. Lone suggested we try to exchange the buffer that the protein is dissolved in, and that actually worked. A summary of results, these numbers really don't mean much to anybody, really, except for us. We have pure DNA in high concentrations. We have protein in milligram quantities, which is a lot of protein. And we have some appropriate crystallization conditions for DPO4. We also have lots of ways of how not to crystallize DPO4. And within the past week or so, we actually have gotten crystals, which is a huge step. So that means that we're ready now to actually start working with our each specific lesions and obtaining crystals for diffraction. So the future plans include, which I am hoping to continue in the fall, are to crystallize DPO4 with my DNA lesion thymine glycol, optimize these crystallization conditions to get the very best crystals I possibly can, and then we'll send these crystals to be diffracted. And from these electron clouds, from the diffraction patterns, we can determine the structure, which is the end of the whole project. I'd like to thank the Adrian Tinsley Program and everybody involved with it, especially Dr. Wright, Dr. McClendon, and Kathy. I'd also like to thank Bethany and Melissa for all their help in the lab, and especially Dr. Lone for not killing me. And for all of them.